How come you become the adopter of engineered solutions? As like an early adopter, when people just starting to learn about it, you already are acquiring this.
Hard to abate sector is the one who will need the CDR the most, and we thought, you know, we have to start working for supporting CDR market to grow, rather than being a free rider, just wait and buy the cheap tech credit in 2050.
Good day. I am Eugene Zamastianin, Director Commercial from 1.5, and today we're joined by Ms. Kazura Koda, General Manager for Mitsui O.S.K. Lines Carbon Desk.
I've been working for MOL over 12 years for now, and majority of my career has been focused on shipping and transporting our energy, focusing on liquefied natural gas.
When people think about shipping, I guess, if I remember correctly, it's 3 to 4% roughly of total emissions globally. Mm-hmm. So not something to sneeze at, right? So this is a big number.
Yeah.
And it's notoriously infamous for being very slow to decarbonize. It's a big ship, no pun intended. Mm-hmm. What are the key challenges here?
So there are around 50,000 ships engaged in international maritime trade, which emits around 7 million tons of CO2 annually. This is almost equivalent to 2%. You mentioned 3 to 4, but currently 2%. And this is almost the same size as the emission of Germany. And we have a huge emission even now, but due to the growth of international commerce, we expect international maritime trade could be triple in 2050 compared to the level of 2019. So without the ambitious decarbonization, I think, you know, our emission from international shipping could undermine the global effort to meet the Paris Agreement target. So we need a really, really ambitious decarbonization actions.
So maybe in this spirit of talking about changes and challenges, maybe you can touch on IMO had a watershed moment, I think. Mm-hmm. When was that? July, I believe, right? So MEPC 80, it is not a policy, it is a strategy, and it's a guiding principle right now. But maybe a simple question, like, does it give you great expectation that something is going to happen soon, and the growth that you expect in will be matched with a growing ambition in decarbonization of the industry?
We shipping industry has been somehow lagging behind in terms of climate action for a long time, because we have a lot of stakeholders and really had to, you know, agree on something. But this summer, we have IMO's revised strategy for emission reduction. And now we have the industry-wide target to achieve net zero. So we, MOL, we have net zero 2050 target already 2 years ago, set 2 years ago. And we also have short to mid-term milestones that are already in line with the industry's new target. So we are, you know, the industry is somehow catching up to our activities, and I think we are going to a right direction.
It's a great position to be a leader of the industry. So maybe just pivoting a little bit from the industry to MOL itself. I believe May this year, late May, you published the MOL Group's environmental strategy 2.2. What were the major evolution steps in your strategy from 1.0 to where you are right now with 2.2? Yeah. And by the way, like, stellar document. I love to show it to other people as an example of what the strategy looks like, especially as, I don't remember, page 28, I think, that's about the CDRs.
When we started our journey, we were just actually following the industrial regulation, meaning we are just aiming to achieve net zero within this century. But after the Paris Agreement agreed, you know, Paris Agreement analysis, our customer is moving, you know, gradually towards the decarbonization. And at the time, shipping was outside of the Paris regime, mm-hmm. but we are aware, unless we cope with the higher ambition of Paris target, we will not be chosen by our customers. So with that recognition, we set net zero 2050 target in 2021. So due to the hard to abate nature of the industry, we expect there may be some residual emission around 10% of the current level, even in 2050. So we need CDL. But when we started our journey, we didn't know what kind of solution we could seek. But at least we decided, you know, we will not wait for 2050 someone to supply CDL, but we have to work with our stakeholders to create this market itself. So in this, you know, updated version, Environmental Vision 2.2, we didn't change our net zero target year, but we put additional milestones, mm-hmm. including CDL commitment. So we now target to retire 2.2 million tons of CDR credit by 2030, and hope we are sending a proper demand signal to the market.
Right now, we see a lot of companies that we talk to who are afraid to take action. Mm-hmm. They don't know what the solution is, and they're just kind of paralyzed by this fear that whatever they pick is going to be maybe deemed wrong at some point in time. And so they just pause and step back without doing anything. So when somebody kind of steps up and says, we don't know what exactly the answer is, but we're going to do at least something, we're going to start moving things forward, you take a lot of risk with that.
We thought we have to do, you know, more ambitious action, not only reducing our emission, but also we have to contribute to the societal, you know, mitigation actions. Then we thought, you know, our focus on CDL could fit into that purposes. You know, supporting CDL can be a, you know, part of our beyond the value chain mitigation, which is a new norm for our sustainability agenda. So somehow we are taking risks, but at the same time, we are sure this is a right path companies have to take.
De-risking by taking risk. It's almost like that. No, this is great. I really appreciate it. This is a really great answer. What are you looking at? What are the decarbonization pathways that you're kind of following? Or maybe mm-hmm. highlighting even. Mm-hmm. And so that's through 2050. And then maybe just kind of as a snippet of that, like what does it look like in the next 7 years?
We actually have a net zero pathway, and majority of our reduction come from the introduction of energy efficiency measures. We are highly focusing on the usage of wind power. And another, you know, large part come from switching to the cleaner fuels. And in the long term, we will completely switch to ammonia or hydrogen or any other natural fuels. So for the short term, we have several milestones, such as introducing liquefied natural gas fueled vessels. We also have absolute GHG emission reduction target as well. We also commit to use our net zero fuel at least 5% of whole energy usages. So those are really ambitious targets. But as a company, we have 2035 target. Since that is a more realistic timing, we can have cleaner fuel, ammonia or hydrogen. Towards that pathway, we cannot force a bunker supplier to produce clean fuel, but we have to proactively create the supply chain to scale up the clean fuel, which will be the majority of which will play the majority of our decarbonization action. Mm-hmm. So we are actually working closely with suppliers to create the supply chain and expand our value chain itself. So this can be a challenge, but can be a business opportunities as well.
You mentioned the wind power. I think I read recently you're running a trial on Lake Biwa. So I was passing, I was looking, I didn't see it there.
It's actually a hydrogen production.
Is it hydrogen?
Right.
Ah, okay.
So, so now we are using wind power for reducing the emission from our existing vessels.
I see.
But using that mechanism, we are actually creating the hydrogen on ship without using any, you know, powers.
So, so eventually you're thinking potentially it's going to be a vessel that will be traveling on the fuel created as it travels.
Right.
On that same vessel.
Yeah, that's very ambitious target, but we are doing that.
That's, that's really creative. Very important question for us, really, is that how come you become the adopter of engineered solutions as like an early adopter? When people just starting to learn about it, you already are acquiring this.
When we started the journey for CDL, we firstly focused on nature-based solutions and participated in a blue carbon project, which is to restore mangrove ecosystem in Indonesia. And we think nature-based solution is really important, and we wish to support more for the sake of creating societal core benefits, such as protecting biodiversity and improving the livelihood of local people. But the more we study about CDL, the more we recognize the importance of tech-based solutions as well, because according to IPCC, we need CDL around 10 gigatons as a medium, as a median target.
Yeah.
And I don't think nature-based solution alone can satisfy such demand. And for that purpose, tech-based solution have to go to fill the gap. Then, you know, hard to abate sector is the one who will need the CDR the most. And we thought, you know, we have to start working for supporting CDR market to grow rather than being a free rider just wait and buy the cheap tech credit in 2050.
It very much aligns with how we think about it and why tech-based removals are actually critical for the industry. And it's really great to see that people are not waiting on the sidelines until it develops, but rather just go in early on and support the industry growth. So that's, thank you very much for that, for sure. If you were approached right now by a company, Japanese or otherwise, keen to get going in the decarbonization towards like CDR space, what would be the recommendation that you would give them or advice that you would give them?
Pray aim high. It's really important thing, but it's, you know, saying that it's really easy. And how to incorporate the strategy into, you know, us, how to incorporate that ambition into the strategy is the most difficult part, I guess. But, you know, our net zero target itself is the industrial norm, and you cannot distinguish. And if you need CDR in the future, unless you start building the relationship with stakeholders in this space, you cannot just, you know, enter into the market in 2050 and just buy. So you have to nurture the relationship with players and stakeholders and build trust. In that way, you can have a great presence in this market that can be really significant, you know, impact in the future planet as well.
I love what I do, and I love talking about this. So maybe if you can share something, like what really motivates you in this space?
Yeah, I'm also passionate about CDR field, especially because I love solving a really, really difficult problem. You know, we need CDR not only for 2050, but also for this century to remove the historical emission. And I do really care about the future generation, thinking about my future kids. And we have to take action now, otherwise they will suffer a lot in the future. So, you know, working for CDL is really exciting, not only because this is difficult, but this can be doable with, you know, a lot of collective actions.